Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Jewish Museum. My name is Jenna Weiss. I'm the manager of public programs, and thank you for joining us for this morning's Lines of Distinction lecture given by Susan L. Braunstein. The Lines of Distinction lecture has been endowed by Barbara and Benjamin Zucker in memory of Lottie and Charles Zucker. It is also endowed by the late Susan Halo Kalem, Ruth Halo Landman, and William W. Halo in memory of Dr. Gertrude Halo. We are saddened to share with you that William Halo passed away on Friday, and we would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge Mr. Halo's generous support to the Jewish Museum over the years. Susan Braunstein has worked at the Jewish Museum for over 30 years, beginning as a research associate and eventually advancing to her current position as Henry J. Leir Curator. Upon assuming the position, she increased her responsibilities from the historical, ceremonial art, and antiquities collections to encompass contemporary Judaica as well. Dr. Braunstein has previously worked in the Department of Egyptian, Classical, and Near Eastern Art at the Brooklyn Museum. Over her time here at the Jewish Museum, she has worked on numerous exhibitions, including As It Were, So to Speak, a museum collection in dialogue with Barbara Bloom, the first iteration of the Masterpieces and Curiosities series, A Medieval Aquamanile, An Artist Remembers, Hanukkah Lamps Selected by Maurice Sendak, A Hanukkah Project, Daniel Liebskin's Line of Fire, and The Dead Sea Scrolls, Mysteries of the Ancient World. She will be speaking today about her current project, Repetition and Difference, which features both ceremonial objects and contemporary art that are produced in multiples, and will explore the meaning that can be found in the difference within the repetition. In 2004, Dr. Braunstein completed a 7-year project of cataloging the museum's collection of 1,022 Hanukkah lamps. This resulted in two major publications released by Yale University Press, a selection of highlights and a complete catalog of the collection. For details about all of our upcoming public programs, please visit our website or sign up for our e-news and take a moment to silence your cell phones before joining me in welcoming Susan Braunstein.
Well, good morning, and thank you, Jenna, for that wonderful introduction, and thanks to all of you for coming out on this finally sunny morning. As you heard from Jenna's introduction, I am the Hanukkah lamp queen, so that's why so many of my projects have been devoted to Hanukkah lamps, because I did publish all of our lamps, but that leads into this exhibition. The exhibition, which is on the second floor, is called Repetition and Difference, and it explores how artists work in multiples, whether they're contemporary artists or commercial artists or artisans making things for the market, and how those things often have embedded in them differences, and it's those differences that often give us very important insights about society or human condition, artistic production, all kinds of things that we didn't realize that we could learn. And the exhibition has an origin story. It goes back about 3 years when Claudia Gould was a new director at the time, and she was learning about so many facets of the institution, one of which was our collections and how do we collect and why. And she asked each of the curators responsible for a section of the collection to give her a vision statement about what we're doing with that piece of the collection. And I'm in charge of the antiquities and the Judaica. And so I, you know, gave a nice vision statement, and I felt compelled in that statement to say that the museum has a tremendous amount of depth in the types of objects that we have, by which I mean we have multiple copies of exactly the same thing, Hanukkah lamps, Torah binders, you name it, and that normally, curators do go through the collections and purge them occasionally because they have so many. Storage is difficult, keeping track of things is expensive, and we occasionally do look at the collection and, you know, sort of prune it, and it's healthier for the collection as well. But I would never get rid of those duplicates, those multiples, because in the course of my research, and it was for the Hanukkah lamp project, I realized how important they were, how much information they gave me. And so she queried me and she said, well, what do you mean? You know, please explain this. And so I gave her an example of some brass cast Hanukkah lamps from Eastern Europe that at first glance looked identical, but as I studied them, I realized that there were interesting things going on with the castings that gave me information about how long this was in production and where it was in production and why maybe it was in production for so long. And so I talked a lot about technical aspects of it. And one of the other curators at this meeting, this was a curatorial meeting, said, oh my God, that's so fascinating. You should make an exhibition about that. And so that's how this all got born. And even at the time, we said, yes, we'll look at the historic collection, but we would like to show it in some kind of a contemporary lens, because that's what we're trying to do here at the museum. We have a number of contemporary curators and a number of curators who work with more historic material, and what we want to do is to show the Judaica in a more contemporary light that's more relevant to people today. So, I'm sorry, are you? Oh, it's, is that better? Is that better? Okay, sorry. Okay, I'm sorry to have assaulted your eardrums. What we're going to do, as I explained, what we do in the exhibition is to show these multiples from the collection in the context of contemporary works by artists who are either emerging or internationally established. And we show that there are reasons for the repetitions, but there are also differences within the repetitions that do tell us about social and religious conditions, political events, economic issues, or artistic production. So before I get into the meat of this, I'd like to discuss, well, what is a multiple? What do we consider a multiple? Let me just see which I prefer. So artists have worked, produced copies, multiples, repetitions in many different ways. One of them is a repetition of a theme at various points in the artist's life. So during the course of their life, they keep revisiting the same idea and doing it in several different ways. And for example, you see that here with Edvard Munch's The Scream. One of these was done in 1895, the other was done in 1910. Now, these works were never really meant to be displayed together, as we are doing in the exhibition today. But an artist who did start thinking about series and serialization was Monet, who did a whole series of studies of haystacks at different times of the day with different lighting and different weather. And these were actually displayed in 1877 in Paris all together as a series. So we get the idea of serialization as another way that we have multiples. You can have a copy of a work of art. Here you have the magnificent Michelangelo's David and someone making a replica of it. A work of art can also be mechanically reproduced, whether you have a photograph of it, or a print of it, or someone took a video of it, or a selfie. All of these things are ways of replicating a work of art. We also have ready-mades, artists who take something that's commercially produced and declare or turn it into a work of art. Marcel Duchamp did that in 1917 with his fountain. During the course of his lifetime, he also repeated that a number of times in a number of different ways. The first one was actually lost, and so he always had to buy a new one in order to create the work. And as you see, they're not quite the same. So here you have difference already. And of course, another way of copying or making multiples is appropriation, taking another work of art by somebody else and using it in your own work, modifying it in some way, shape, or form that makes it your own. And we have Andy Warhol's Mona Lisa, in which, of course, he's making his comments about commodification of art, etc. And then finally, we get to what we have in our collection, which is number of artists who are trying to make the same type of object, some blueprint that they have in their head, something that's popular that they want to reproduce. And these things are very similar. They look very similar to each other. They have the same material, the same technique, the same style. And so we often call this a type, and there are many different ways to define a type, very broadly or very loosely or very tightly. This, what I'm showing you here, are three Hanukkah lamps from our collection, which I would call a very tight type because they kind of look the same. And you'll notice, let me see if I can turn. Oops. and talk to you at the same time. So there's a menorah in the middle, two lions with their heads facing backwards, a crown at the top. There's all this open work here and lovely Rococo scrolls, etc. So this is a type that actually originated in the city of Frankfurt in the early 18th century. We're not sure who originated it. That's one of the things that we you know, you can know who made the earliest example of something, but we'll never know if we have all the examples and can really prove that that artist was the originator, the creator of the design. And then this one was made a little later in Frankfurt, and this one was made in the early 19th century in another city called Darmstadt. So you see the type is spreading out from Frankfurt and people are adopting it. It was quite popular in Frankfurt, and so there are a number of examples around. I think there are 30 or so by the same artist named Rutger Herford, just him alone. So this is the kind of thing that we have in our collection. And we can have up to, I don't know, over 100 of a particular type. It depends on how loosely you define it. But in terms of identical things, we can have up to 15 things that look exactly identical to each other. But when you look carefully, there are these variations. So how did we get so many of these multiples? Why did we collect them? Why do we have them? And the first person I attribute that to is a man named Dr. Harry G. Friedman. He was a collector who in the 30s gave his collection on loan to our parent organization, the Jewish Theological Seminary. And then at some point, he just began collecting en masse. He would go to all of the thrift shops on Second Avenue when people were, I guess, selling their stuff. They didn't want it anymore. And he would buy anything that was Jewish, and he would just give it to us. He'd send it to us. And then the curators would have to, like, write up. They'd get, you know, boxes full of things, and they would have to, like, catalog them and write up, and they would send him the cataloging information of what he had given them. And he gave us over 6,000 objects. And there were just a tremendous amount of duplicates in what he was doing. And I think that he just felt that it was important to save Judaica no matter what. What was going on, certainly he was beginning to what was going on in Europe with the Holocaust in the 40s and the post-Holocaust period. I think there was this sort of fervor to collect anything that had survived the Holocaust. These were things that were really mostly brought by immigrants here before the Holocaust. So we have a lot of Eastern European is the biggest section of our collection because of the huge waves of Eastern European immigrants beginning in the 1880s. We also have German material from two waves of German immigration, one in the mid-19th century and one right before, in the 30s, right before people couldn't get out anymore. So I think there was this notion that, you know, that after the war, certainly we had to preserve everything that we could find. And also there was a lot of assimilation. So people were getting rid of the stuff. They didn't want it anymore, or it was too old fashioned. And there was this idea that we should preserve it for posterity. And a number of our collections were actually rescued from the Holocaust. So they come in large collections from the community of Danzig, for example, and from a collector named Benjamin Mintz from Warsaw, who was able to get out his collection a month or two before the Nazis invaded Poland. And he actually got it here under the guise of showing it at the World's Fair in New York. Although it never got shown, it got out, and we were able to get it eventually. So between all of this, we wind up with a lot of multiples. And I guess you have to ask, well, why did they make so many multiples? And I think that what they are really representing is sort of not the elite who were able to, you know, have fabulous silver objects that were designed by the finest silversmiths, and they're two or three of a kind. But these are the folks who are more, let's say, upper middle class or middle class, who could afford the heavy brass objects, some silver, simple silver objects, Torah binders made by the local artists, whatever it is, but they, you know, they weren't the wealthiest, and so there's just more of them. That more people could afford them, and more people had them, and so I think that's what they represent, which to me is very endearing, because that's my background. You know, curators often focus on the one single treasure, and they put it in a case like a jewel, and you know, and that's the single thing that you look at like a gem. And I think that here we're showing masses of them, and I think this really, you'll see if you go see the show, has its own kind of beauty. So that's, I think, why so many were made. we find is that they are in production, the same type, this thing, for example, I don't know when this stopped, probably in the, only after 100 years, but we have some that continue in production for 200 years, exactly the same thing being produced. And so you have to wonder, why did people want this over and over and over again, the same thing? And I think that a lot of it has to do with some kind of symbolic value that it must have had to the people, that it represented something, whether it was the iconography on it or just the whole gestalt of it, the way it was made, etc., represented something to them, possibly stability and continuity in times. You know, Jewish life was often very precarious, so this is something you could, this continuity was something you could hold on to. It could also be a trigger of personal or communal memory. It enabled you to reenact the tradition and the history of Judaism. And also it could evoke, just be evoking nostalgia. You may, you know, be assimilated, but this is something that really has some meaning to your past, especially during times of disruption or modernization or even immigration, coming to a new country and wanting to have something from the old country. Another thing that they could be communing is geographic identity. There's a lot of these types are unique to certain cities or certain countries. You know, they really are very specific. You can say where that something was made. And I think, you know, in Judaism, we have a lot of overall arching things that we all do and that unite us. But as we all know, the joke about the two Jews and the three synagogues on the desert island, there's always, you know, different ways of doing things within Judaism, because we don't have a single pope or whatever, a figure who is making rulings and everybody follows those rulings. We are free to interpret the tradition as we wish. So I think that, in a sense, the Jews of Isfahan or the Jews of Lvov were saying, these are our, you know, this represents us, this is our tradition, and we're very proud of it, and we take it with us wherever we go. So I think that geographic origin is another thing that may have caused the thing to keep being produced over and over in time. And it certainly might be just economic. Once you create molds or something, you just keep producing them over and over again. Why bother to create something new? But there still has to be a demand to buy what you're producing. So it works, it takes two to tango. Well, I've just been talking about stability and how these things stayed steady over time. We often think of ritual as representing this kind of very unchanging thing, but it can also facilitate change. We find that it does, and it can mediate between tradition and adaptation. Scholars are doing a lot of studies about that with different cultures today. And just as no ritual can be repeated exactly the same way twice, I think the seemingly identical Judaica objects have differences that are both subtle and obvious. I think I'm going to skip over this part. Just a little bit of background about multiples in general and attitudes towards them, because the attitudes of artists and critics and consumers have changed quite a lot over the millennia. And I would say that up to the late 18th century, copies and multiples were just accepted. It didn't matter that one was a copy and one was an original. People just enjoyed them. But starting in the 19th century and maybe the late 18th century, the sort of romantic ideal of the artist as a unique individual and his artwork or her artwork as unique works of art came to the fore. And there was often a lot of wondering, like, which was the first one, which was the original, and which were the copies. And so it sort of privileged this notion that an original has an aura. It is, you know, special and unique, and you have to see the original and not the copy. The copies are considered pejorative. But in the 20th century, there were some seminal treatises that changed or reflected changing attitudes towards it. First of all, you get Duchamp and artists who are playing around with this notion of what is art and copies and multiples. But there was a philosopher or a critic named Walter Benjamin, who in 1936 wrote a treatise called Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction. And he argued that the aura of an original was no longer important, and that copies, mechanical copies, photographs of something, replicas of something, can be seen as independent of that original and are often the only thing that people will see. They'll see a postcard of the Mona Lisa, but they'll never get to see the Mona Lisa, and sort of flipping it so that the postcard becomes the original and the Mona Lisa is something that's far away and inaccessible. And then leading us to the title of the exhibition, Repetition and Difference, there was a philosopher named Gilles Deleuze who in 1968 wrote a treatise called Difference and Repetition, in which he argued that the concepts of difference and repetition in philosophy are normally considered pejorative. If something is different, it means that there's an original somewhere that is good, and this is different from it. It's not good. And the same with repetition. If something repeats something, there's an original that's good, that's out there, that's the original, and this is just some kind of unimportant copy. And he turned it around, and he felt that repetition was an important force, a dynamic force for creativity, and what made it so was the fact that there was differences embedded in it. Don't ask me to tell you any more about this treatise. It is impenetrable. I tried to read it. It's really a philosophical proof. And since I really know nothing about philosophy, and there's mathematics and all kinds of things in it, but that is the gist of what he's trying to say and the gist of what we are trying to say in the exhibition. So by focusing on multiples, works that are, I consider, popular works, I'm trying to make a case for the place of these multiples and the value of them, of these Judaica works, within the larger artistic tradition of repetition and difference. So let's look at some examples. And, okay, I'll just do this, right? Okay. I chose, in the end, 8 different types, groups of work. Altogether, there are over 350 works of Judaica, because there are multiples. And most of them are from our collection. I have to, you know, truth in advertising, I have to tell them it all come from the collection, because there were 2 types that I just thought were so fascinating that I wanted to explore, and we didn't have very many examples of. So I did borrow some. And I wound up just choosing works that I found fascinating, that were aesthetically compelling to me, and also had some fascinating stories of, you know, that emerged about why they were repeated and why they were different. And the information that they gave was very interesting and compelling to me. So that's how I wound up choosing them. And I worked with a co-curator who was doing the contemporary material, and so I showed him the stuff, and he was a great audience for my reviewing these things, because he didn't know Judaica very well, and so he could respond just to them as works of art, and that was just a great partnership with Jens Hoffman, who was the deputy director of the museum. So these figurines that I'm showing you now are, we call them pillar figurines. They come from the southern Israel, which was the kingdom of Judah, from the 8th to the, they date from the 8th to the 7th century BCE, so they're pretty old. They're about 6 inches tall, and they have a very interesting image of the female body. You see that, oh, I did the wrong thing, sorry. They have this pillar base, which enables them to stand. They always have these prominent breasts with their hands underneath. And then they have the heads, and there's 2 types of heads. One is a mold-made head, it's formed in a mold, and the other is a pinched head, which is just made out of the body and pinched up. And so what's interesting to me is that there's no, you would think, you know, with these prominent breasts that these must be fertility figurines of some kind. They're showing a woman, whatever, I don't know if she's alluring or she's nursing or what she's doing, but she's offering or supporting her breasts. What's interesting is there are no genitalia shown here. That's what you usually find on a fertility figurine, because the children will come out of the womb, and they're usually shown on female figurines. So that's what I find, there's a very particular kind of image that they're trying to project here, and they do so for 200 years, from the 8th to the 7th century. These are found, about 1,000 of them have been found. So here you can see in close-up the different head types, and so this one is rather what we call Egyptianizing, because she has a wig on with little curls. And what they found is that there's hardly any repetition even though they're made in molds, you'd expect to find exact copies of each other, because they're made in a mold. But we don't find almost no repetitions there, she's probably some kind of Egyptianizing figure. What she's doing in southern Judah, I don't know. We don't know. And then this one is much more mask-like, and the question is, you know, why is that different? Is it possible that they didn't want to represent the human face? They wanted to, or it was a different ceremony that they were using it, and it's more of a mask, some kind of performance. There is a difference in sort of where they're found and when they're found, but so that could say that different people were using different versions of this figure, but that's all we can say. And we can't figure out her function. She's usually found discarded. They're usually found broken and thrown away in homes, in cisterns, in courtyards. And some of them are found intact in tombs, whether they were put there, you know, to be because it's part of a ritual, but not to be buried with the dead. We don't know. And there's been a number of interpretations, but I just want to show you that they're sometimes found with these other types of figurines. One is a model of a couch, and the other is a bird figurine. I think ours was found together with these two things in a tomb. So are these, what are these? Are these toys? Are these some kind of ritual objects? Of course, archaeologists, when they can't explain something, always say it's a cult object. So when I first started working here, and I did a show in which I showed our figurine, in 1982, we interpreted her as either a cult object. She was used in worship in some way, I don't know, a votive figurine or something you kept in your house and you worshiped. She could have had some kind of amuletic magic, or maybe she was just toys. Then in 1993, when we redid the permanent exhibition, there was this whole buzz about this goddess named Asherah. An inscription was found that said Yahweh and his Asherah. And that expression is also seen in the Bible. And so people began to say, wow, maybe Yahweh had a consort, just like everyone else. Asherah is the name of a goddess, and he had a wife, just like all the other gods in antiquity before true monotheism really hit. He had a wife. And so that's how I interpreted her, because Asherah is often described as being a pillar in the temple in Jerusalem. And so pillar figurine, Asherah. We love that association. It seemed to really fit. And so I actually interpreted her, maybe she was Asherah. And then in 1996, a major publication of the figurines came out by this graduate student, and he poo-pooed that idea, and he said, it's just probably some kind of domestic ritual or magic that was going on. And finally, in 2012, somebody did her dissertation on this, and she came to the conclusion that maybe they were just used in magical rituals for protection, and that what you did was somehow you put the evil, whatever it was that you wanted to get rid of, on the figurine, and it was discarded in some way. And maybe that's why we find so many broken examples in these contexts. But whatever it is, she's thrown out. We don't find her in sort of original context. So this is an example of something in archaeology that we don't really know the function of, but it's just an open-ended kind of fascinating thing. And so what I liked about this is just the way it looks, and also the fact that the differences in the head types can really maybe represent a number of ways of thinking about the female body and the performance of the ritual that we unfortunately can't reconstruct but can only guess at. I'm sort of working my way up from antiquity to more modern times. So now we are in the 2nd century BCE to the 1st century CE, and these are silver shekels or coins that were minted in the city of Tyre, which is in Lebanon today, starting in 126-25 BCE. Why that year? Because that's when Tyre became independent from Greece. And in that period, whenever you became independent, you had your own sovereignty, the first thing you did was to mint a coin proclaiming, you know, who you are. And what figure represented on it is the city god Melkart, who is a form of Heracles or Hercules. And if you notice, over here, he's got that knot, which represents the, Hercules always had a lion skin knotted around his neck, and so that's what you're seeing over here. And These coins were highly prized throughout the ancient world because Tyre had somehow managed to make silver coins that had a very high percentage of silver, not a lot of impurities, and the weight was very standardized. So there wasn't a lot of variation in the value of the coin. They're worth one shekel, but in those days they didn't have good weight scales and finely calibrated things, and so there's a lot of variation in the weight. But somehow they had managed to create a high level of standardization, which was prized throughout the ancient Near East. And what I love about this is that although the silver was standardized, the imagery is standardized, they produced this head of Melkart for whatever it's over 150 years, but the image is always different in every single one of them. How were they created? They took the blank of silver and somebody took a die, put it on top, and hammered it several times in order to create the image. And that human action of hammering created a wide variety of placement. You can see, you know, they're off center. Sometimes you see the beading, sometimes you don't. And sometimes they're very deep, and sometimes they're very shallow. Sometimes you can't hardly see the image. So I love that sort of contrast between the standardization of the government requirements and the human element. In addition, they would change the die every few years. And so what you get, and the easiest way to see it, they try to replicate exactly the same figure, but they seem to always throw in a couple of little differences. And the one that I notice the most is on the side curls. I always wonder if they're meant to be payas. And this one has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 spirals, whereas this one only has 2. So you can start, if you look really closely at them, you start seeing the differences in the molds that were made, the dies, as well as the human element in the striking of them. And so what we finally realize is that the coin was valued, as long as it somehow was marked as Tyre, as you could recognize it as Tyre, it didn't matter how the image was produced on it, and there's an inscription on the other side how that was produced. As long as it was Tyrian, you know, you could trust it. Why do we have these in the Jewish Museum? Because Tyre is in Lebanon, and this is not a Jewish god. It turned out that the Jews, too, wanted to have the most standardized and, you know, coins in the realm, and so they required that you had to use Tyrian shekels in order to pay your temple dues, in order to buy anything at the temple, any offerings, any exchanges that you did with the temple, you had to use Tyrian shekels. So, and so somebody once asked, well, you know, how could they use this coinage that had in the temple that had a foreign god on it? And it turns out the Talmud, of course, deals with this and says that if it's a viable coin, then its function is as a coin, and it doesn't matter. You're not worshiping it, and it's okay. But if you were to use it as a piece of jewelry or some other context other than buying commodity, then it's not okay, and you can't use that. You can't use that coin with that image. So the rabbis, you know, thought of everything, and so these were allowed to be used and actually required for the temple. So this was actually the group of lamps that I was thinking of when I was describing the duplication in our collection to our new director, Claudia Gould. And these are lamps that come from Eastern Europe. They probably began making them in the 18th century, and they probably continued all the way through the end of the 19th and maybe into the 20th. So that's 200 years of production. And you'll see that they're united by the fact that there's this heavy cast openwork brass. They're made of a number of pieces, a backplate, side pieces, the candle holders, and there's always 2 candle holders, the row of 8 lights, and a frontispiece. So there's a lot of different parts that have to be put together, and they're always, you know, sort of assembled in the same way. And so that's kind of what we would say is a very broad type, because at first glance they all look the same. And as a matter of fact, when I started showing these to people in the museum, and I had pulled a whole bunch of ones that I thought were different types, and I put them together and asked them, you know, I was trying to find figure out how many I needed to display, you know, how many would make a really fantastic display. We get the point across, so I pulled out about 18 of them, and they were all different backplate types, different designs on them. And my colleagues came in and looked at them, and they said, these are all the same. I said, what? No, they're not, because there are actually different designs on the backplates. So here you've got the two, where's a good one here? Here you've got these two deer that are kneeling in front of an acanthus plant. And then you've got this design where there's a vase with these sort of snakes on either side. Here's another one with the deer. So I was just going to do the deer. We had about 7 examples of just those deer, and I was going to borrow some more. So I was trying to figure out how many did I have to borrow to make a nice assortment. And they all said, no, these all look the same. So I thought, this is great. This is a different kind of a repetition where we have a very broadly defined group all made the same way and have a similar appearance. But if you look closely, you'll see that the back plates are different. The designs on them are generally deer, as you see, lions and birds, sometimes eagles, and with a lot of scroll work. And this comes both out of Russian or Eastern European, Polish sort of Baroque decoration, a lot of scroll work with animals inside it that the Jews adopted. But I think it also comes from an expression that was very common in Judaica from Poland and Eastern Europe, which is from the Ethics of the Fathers. And it says, be bold as a leopard, light as an eagle, swift as a deer, and strong as a lion to do the will of your father who is in heaven. And we find a lot of those animal combinations in Eastern European Judaica. So that's what you see here. So there you've got your deer, and then you've got lions. Two lions that are actually circling a double-headed eagle. So this may have several different meanings because the double-headed eagle is the symbol of the Prussian Empire, Russian Empire, or the Austrian Empire. All of them, I think, because they descend from the Holy Roman Empire, so they all adopted the double-headed eagle. And here are these deer. So within, as I said, there was that broad group, and then within that, exactly the same back plates that we had, and that's when I began to study them and realized that we could see that there were several generations. You know, if you understand anything about casting, you take a model, it's a flat thing, and you press it into sand, you take it out, you pour your molten metal inside, and when it cools, you have a casting from that model. And you'll use that maybe a model many times. It can, you know, decay, things can break off of it, but we find that they kept using them over and over, even after things happened to them. And eventually they decide to replace it, and they take a casting from that, and they use that for the next generation of Hanukkah lamps. So that casting has both the flaws of the first generation, first model, and it's also 2% smaller. So I started tracing all these generations, and I saw how long these things were in production, and I saw how the way they were put together changed over time. So that enabled me to apply it to other lamps that I didn't have generations for, and so it was a very useful sort of connoisseurship thing for me to be able to understand a lot about these lamps and their the longevity. So here you have one of the earliest lamps of this series of the two deer, and you can see that the lines are very thin and delicate and beautifully modeled. There's still the edgings are still here. Unfortunately, the top of this broke off, but not during casting. It broke off because it's so old, and this is probably late 18th century. And then you see that over time things happen in the mold, and so I just want to point out, first of all, these birds here with their heads turned back, and there's their lovely heads. In this piece, here's the bird, but the head's completely missing. It's just lost in the model, and they cast it that way, didn't care. Other things happen, like this leg gets closed over. It should be like this, but it gets filled in, and they just leave it like that. These things were missing, and they just left it, you know, they cast it that way. These should be holes, but they, which in the original casting are actually cast in. Later on, they do close up, so they drill through them. You can tell that that's a later casting. So all kinds of things happen, and I was able to just notice how that didn't seem to matter, that the things were defective, that there was something wrong with them, they weren't well produced, they just continued in production for over 200 years. So I think that notion of the symbolic value is kicking in here, and for some reason this particular lamp was very important. This is the most common group of Hanukkah lamps that we have in the collection, the largest group of these brass cast things. Why? Because this is what they brought from Eastern Europe when they came. We found out that this brass was so valuable that they brought the Hanukkah lamps, they brought the brass candlesticks, and they brought the mortar and pestle for whatever they're grinding up in the kitchen. Because brass was actually valuable. Nowadays we consider it very cheap, but the materials to make brass are not easily found, and in those days, you know, with the methods that they had then of mining, and so that's why we have so many of them, because they were valued and they were brought here during the East European immigration. All right. Another group of objects that I just loved were these marriage contracts. They come from Isfahan, and we have 9 altogether. I was only able to show 8 because that's all that fit in the gallery. But they are all united by a very similar iconography that continued. Our earliest is 1818, and I think that's one of the earliest known of this type. Our latest is 1830, but it continues into the 1840s. 1930, and continues into the 1940s. I've seen examples of. So what is the type? You see that there is this architectural frame here, and there's a little columns here, etc. There's arches, etc. And there in the center, we have the motif of a cypress tree, which is flanked by 2 lions with the sun behind them. And that is the symbol of the Persian Empire. The Jews of Isfahan were the only Jews to use that symbol on their ketubot, their marriage contracts, and the reason is probably because Isfahan was the capital of the Persian Empire for many, many years until 1722, and it's possible that the Jews of Isfahan were, you know, in the capital, they were kind of the premier community, and so they chose to put this on their marriage contract. We do have examples of Jews putting national symbols on their marriage contracts, but this one is an early and very interesting example. The other aspect of that is this floral background. You see here it's they're more naturalistic flowers and very tightly done. And then as we move through time, 1854, 1879, suddenly we get these very, much more quickly produced flowers, much larger. They look to always, I always think they're like a cat walked over the, had his feet dipped in red paint and he walked all over the ketubah. But the iconography sort of remains the same, the central tree. Sometimes it differs, sometimes there's a vase. And I think that in both cases that is meant to represent long life, longevity. Certainly the cypress tree is a symbol of long life, and I think going back to antiquity, the symbol of a vase with vines flowing out of it also is a symbol of eternal life, let's say. And so that is something you would want to wish long life to a couple who is getting married. But what happens is that at some point, and it seems to be in the 1920s, there's a change in the symbol, and it goes from the lions to, and I think you can see that, to the Star of David with the word Zion or Zion in the center. Our example is from 1930, but I've seen examples that go back at least to the 1920s. And so the question is why? Why did they replace the Persian symbol with a Jewish symbol? And it turns out that in 1917, the Balfour Declaration had been pronounced in England that supported a homeland in Palestine for the Jewish people. And there was a tremendous Zionistic fervor in Persia, as there was throughout the Middle East. And so they started Zionist associations, and they began to think of going, you know, that they could maybe go to the land of Israel, although there had been a number of migrations because conditions were very bad for Jews in the second half of the 19th century in Persia. So I'm getting loud again. And And so I think that's what caused them to start putting this sort of, and the symbol of Zion, which was, you know, kind of promoted by the Zionist, Theodor Herzl, as the symbol of the Zionist movement in the late 19th century, was put on the ketubah as, in the beginning, I think it was more of a spiritual hope for going to the Holy Land after you die, but in the end it became this sort of feeling of reality that we could actually, Jews could actually go there. So I think that's what's going on here. Another group of objects that we wanted to show, this was actually Jens's choice. He just wanted something that kind of had a similar shape that could be repeated over and over again. And this is a case of a very broad definition of a type. Mezuzot, or mezuzot, are of course the scroll that has biblical verses on it that declare one's love of God, and you are commanded to put it on your doorpost. How do you put it on? You have to have some kind of a case in which you can put it in. And so the case has to at least conform to the shape of the scroll, which is cylindrical. And so you get these sort of long, thin objects with a flat back that you can then nail or screw to your doorpost. And so that's sort of the general similarity, the repetition that we're talking about here, which is very broad. And then, but you see that there's just an infinite variety of ways that you can execute this particular need for a case. So you'll see in the exhibition, I tried to organize them sort of by what looks similar, and it turns out what looks similar often is from the same time and place, but not always. What I liked about the mezuzot is that they are put on the outside of the house first. They're all certainly on the inside, but they're a marker that there's a Jewish home here, and they kind of do differentiate the sort of outside space from the inside space where one is supposed to think more spiritually about oneself, but that the mezuzot do reflect the contact with the outside world, because the styles are always bringing in whatever styles are current in that time and place. So here we have some wooden examples. This one is from Europe. This one, these just were hard to photograph, has two birds here. Again, the birds are probably Eastern Europe, maybe 19th century. This one has the wall with the cypress trees on top, the Western wall. This one's from Palestine. This one's from Europe. This one, different style of wood carving, is probably from Germany, 19th century. This one, it turned out, I always thought it was wood and ivory. It turns out it's plastic, but it's made to look like wood, and it's probably early 20th century. I'm hoping I can say that it's Bakelite. I don't know how to analyze Bakelite, but I'll find out. And this last one is a contemporary, not contemporary, but from the 60s by an artist named Irving Potter. And so this sort of wooden series is one of the series that I have on display in the exhibition. And then there's this type that's flat, rectangular and flat, to hold the scroll. And these are almost all Eastern European, all from the 19th century, and you can just see how, they often have this engraved decoration, this flat decoration. This group all have the doors that open, and you can see the scroll inside, usually a crown or something on the top that make them similar. So these are all related. These are, this is more of a Breslau type, but Breslau was Eastern Prussia, so Eastern Germany, so it's very, was very close to Eastern, to Poland. Oh, well, I don't know why that happened, but let me see if the next one is better. Nope. I'm sorry, I don't know how these two got overlapped, but, I'm sorry. The ones on the top are then a cylindrical form. That's another solution to having cylindrical forms. So these three brass ones are from India, actually, from Bombay. And they're replicas, actually, that were made by someone who was concerned that the types were disappearing. So in the 80s, he had some replicas made, but they are replicas of 19th century types. And then this one was made in Peru, in Lima, in 1950. And these, I just love them because the scroll is in a glass holder, so you can actually see it. This one is made in Vienna, and this one, I think, was probably made in the same area as well. And then I have this lovely sequin, I don't know how this happened, I'm sorry, of more contemporary ones that take the letter shin, the letter in Hebrew shin, which stands for Shaddai, Almighty, which is found on the outside of these scrolls, which are often shown poking through the window. And when you have a scroll, a mezuzah case that has a hole in it, you usually see the word Shaddai poking through. So the word shin from Shaddai is put on these series, and this one has a big Shaddai in the middle. This one has a small Shaddai, but continues the, I love the way this one's from the 30s, continues the lines of the Shaddai. And then you have one in which the whole piece, this is from the 60s, is in the shape of a Shaddai. And this one is by, I know his last name is Reese, but I'm blanking out on, remember his first name? Not Lionel Reese, is it? No. I'm sorry, I'm blanking out. And these two are by him. This one he did in the 30s. This one he did, I think, in the 50s when he came to this country. And this one, I believe, is by Leonard Schaefer, who was working in the Toby Pasher workshop here when he created it. So on to another type of object that I was fascinated with. And these are Torah binders. Are you familiar with the German Torah binder? These are long, they're about 10, 11 feet long, that are used to bind, you know, the Torah scroll together when it's not being used. You have to kind of do that, otherwise the rollers will come apart. And in Germany, a particular custom arose of taking the swaddling clothes. A swaddling cloth is often a long, skinny piece of material that you wrap around a child to keep it quiet and comfort it. And so they, for some reason, developed this custom of taking the swaddling cloth of a child who was circumcised, and within a few years after his birth, of putting, of taking it and painting or embroidering something on it, and dedicating it to the synagogue. And when he was like 2 or 3 years old, and then when he was bar mitzvah, they would take it out of the synagogue and use it during his bar mitzvah. They would wrap it around the Torah. And this custom is at least goes back to the 16th century. There is actually a story of maybe of how it began or what enabled it to happen, is that this very famous rabbi was presiding at a circumcision. This may have been the late medieval period. I'm sorry, I can't remember the date or his name at this particular moment in time. And the baby was, I guess, restless, and they wanted to swaddle it, and they didn't have a swaddling cloth. So he said, well, go to the Torah, take out the Torah binder and wrap it around him. Then just clean it afterwards, and you can use it again as a Torah binder. So this is, you know, at least gives the kashrut. This is, you know, it's okay to do this, and the association. And certainly one can say that, you know, a circumcision binds a child to the community and a Torah, you know, and to the Torah. So it's a wonderful metaphor for binding the child to Jewish tradition and the learning and the Torah and the community. That said, what does it say on, there's an inscription on it, what does it say? It always says the same thing. It says so-and-so, the son of so-and-so, the date he was born, and that may God raise him to the Torah, to the marriage canopy, and to good deeds, amen, selah. For 400 years, this continues, you know, very rigidly, this sort of same expression. There are variations sometimes in the language, depending on where they were produced. They started in Germany, but they spread to Denmark and to Alsace and France and other places where Germanic Jews, Ashkenazi Jews went, but not to Eastern Europe. They didn't use them in Eastern Europe. And so having this very formulaic expression, but then they just were emboldened to decorate the letters in the most wildly fanciful, fantastic way. So I see this sort of tension between the conformity to the words of the ritual and to the type of object that it is, and the wish that the child should conform and do all these things, to, you know, study Torah and get married and give charity, but yet there's just this wild exuberance and abandonment in the decoration of the letters. And I'm just going to show you a few examples of the type of decoration. Much of it is this very flat, colorful, highly patterned. Each letter has a different pattern in this. This is just a section of it. This is the representation for God. His name is, this is the letter He, which stands for Hashem. But they made this wonderful roundel around the name of God. And this says, may He... this is one where it's a little bit longer. May he merit, may he deserve to grow up to the Torah. And then there's a usually a representation of the Torah. In this example from Switzerland, the most exquisite kind of depth was given to a very fine hand was able to create this one. And the name of the child is given in French, actually. So that shows the signs of assimilation when they start putting the name of the child. First they give their Yiddish name. These have the Hebrew name. Then they give the Yiddish name, and then eventually they give the name in Roman letters, their secular name. And then the very interesting details happen, like here you see a hand. So the letters themselves are often used to create images. Often it's this letter Lamed, which has an ascender, and they do great things with them. So here you have a hand holding a flag. This is the French flag, and there's a story behind this. This was produced in Alsace in 1872, which was right after it had been seized from France by the Germans. So they are showing their French loyalty by including this in the child's Torah binder. So all kinds of messages also, in addition to the beautiful and very, very decoration, creep into the Torah binders. And just to give you just some examples of what other things they did with the letters, I just love this very whimsical bird. This is another Lamed, an ascender, and this is another where it's now flowers. Here you have, this is the word chupa, marriage canopy, and so they have a figure celebrating and blowing a horn. And then inside the letters, they also put wonderful details like this face. And I don't know, there's a table and chairs here. I don't know if this is a Kiddush decanter and some Kiddush cups. Probably that's what they're trying to represent. And here the entire letter bet is a building. Don't know whether it's because it's Bayit, house. I don't know what the association is, but they just made them. We can't even understand some of these associations now, but there's just wonderful whimsy, and this makes these just wonderful to have this kind of tension between the conformity and the artistic exuberance. Another group of things that I showed were these spice containers. They they're all in the shape of a piece of fruit. Two different types of fruit are shown. One is pear-shaped and one is round, which is could be an apple or a pomegranate. And I just thought these were just so exquisite that I wanted to show them, and I wasn't sure what kind of differences I was going to find. Spice containers are used at the end of the Sabbath. You put spices inside and you use it to smell. It's part of the ceremony that separates the holy day from the rest of the week. And these particular group are found in Poland and in the 19th century, and most of them are from this part of the world. So it's a very sort of circumscribed type. And I always wondered, why fruit? I would have thought flowers, because flowers have a nice smell. Fruits do smell nice, but I would have thought it would be more flowers. And the other thing is, of course, that each one of these you'll see is different from the other. So the artists are trying to create this fruit form container, but they're just very different in the shapes of the fruit and the way the stems curve and the leaves and what else is decorated. But what I did notice as I was going through them was that some of them had snakes on them, and I couldn't understand that. And I know it's gonna be hard to see, but right here is a snake head, so the whole stem is meant to be a snake. Here's another snake head, and again the same thing, and then there's a snake slithering up this branch, and that's its head over there. And so that was a difference that I said, what does that mean? Why are there snakes here? And so I began to do some research. I said, sounds like if I got a piece of fruit and I have a snake, I must have the expulsion. What's the connection between Havdalah, this ceremony at the end of the Sabbath, and the expulsion? And sure enough, there are a number of associations. One of them has to do with smell, and that is in the Kabbalah, in the Zohar, which is an early mystical text. And in the Zohar, it is said that Adam's original clothing before he ate the apple, actually in Judaism it's not an apple, it's a fruit from the tree of knowledge, was some kind of pulsating light, very spiritual. And after he sinned, God made new clothes for Adam and Eve from these aromatic trees that were growing in the Garden of Eden. And Adam was, you know, very kind of upset at having to leave this beautiful, comforting place where he was taken care of, and now he had to go out into the world and fend for himself, and Eve as well. And the smell from the garden is said to have calmed him as he and uplifted his soul. And that is one reason why Jews do smell spices at the end of the Sabbath, which is to comfort them for losing this holy day and having to start the work week. And so I think that there's this, you know, real association. I think this, I've stumbled upon this. No one else has ever said anything about it, so maybe I've discovered something new. But I think, you know, there may be a real connection. And we know that the Jews in Poland were, that's where Hasidism was born, and a number of them were Hasidic and were interested in, involved in mystical traditions and would have read the Zohar and interpreted and would have known it. So that enables us to know sort of the level of knowledge of both the craftspeople and the people who were using these fruit. Someone said that the fruit may represent the myrtle, which was one of the original, centuries before, was the most popular spice to smell during the Havdalah ceremony. But the myrtle fruit, to me, is very small and not quite shaped this way, so I don't accept that interpretation. This is the last piece of Judaica in the show. And these, of course, are skull caps. And you know that many of them have a sort of hemispherical shape to fit on the head. Jews are not required to wear skull cap. Jewish men are not required to wear them, but they do out of a sign of respect for God to keep their head covered. What we noticed is that the skull caps can communicate a lot of information about the person who's wearing it. There's a number of different kinds of information that are communicated, and one is about your geographic location and where you came from. We do find that different styles are found in different countries. So the first one here, we have these Polish skull caps. These were probably for Sabbath and festivals because they're so beautiful and fancy. And these are made with gold metallic thread that's kind of flat and created in these bands that are then sewn onto the skull cap to make these beautiful patterns. It's quite beautiful. This one's from Mumbai, India. It has embroidery and it has beads on it, these white beads that simulate pearls. And this was probably maybe for the high holidays, for Yom Kippur, made in the 20th century. And down here, we have one from Uzbekistan from the early 20th century. And we know that the Jews living there was a life of the outside world was very barren and arid, and they decorated their homes and they dressed in these very colorful costumes and materials and fabrics, and they certainly also put them on their heads. This is embroidered and very colorful, and it comes from the early 20th century. So this is some geographic differences. Then we have things that are for children as opposed to adults. And here we have this exquisite circumcision cap. It has little ties that come down so you can tie it on the child's head. It actually is in the shape of a sleeping cap from the 18th century. This is what people wore to bed, men wore to bed anyway. And it has this beautiful metallic lace and embroidery on it, and it's probably from the 18th or early 19th century. And then in Jerusalem, we find the popularity of white knit skull caps. A number of communities there wear these actually crocheted skull caps. And this one is for a child. It's very small, and it says Jerusalem on it. And it also has this protective inscription, Joseph is a fruitful vine, Yosef ben Porat, which is found on a lot of Middle Eastern Judaica as a protective amuletic inscription. And it's a lovely little beaded cap. Then we have caps that represent different aspects of gender identity. This one here, This one here was produced by an artist named Carrie Leibowitz, and it was it's named for the Stonewall Rebellion, in which gays were being arrested and harassed by the police, and they finally decided to stand up to them, and it was kind of the beginning of the gay liberation movement. And so you see the pink color there is deliberately with the blue and white for Jewish Israel. This one is made by a transgender artist in 2010 named Gil Yefman. He uses the art of crocheting, which he learned from a woman in his family. And it's actually in the shape of a breast. And refers, I think, it's called black breastlev, and I think it refers to other crocheted white kippot that are worn by different sects, one of them the Breslauer sect in Jerusalem. And here we have a lovely crocheted metal kippah made for a woman. So you hear, and then so you're seeing how gender equality and gender issues are coming to the fore in amongst Jewish people and women and other communities. And here today, you can tell somebody's degree of religious affiliation often by the type of skull cap that you wear. So here is the black velvet, the large black velvet skull caps, which are favored by the Haredi, or known as the ultra-Orthodox community. This is black also, but it's crocheted or knit, as they say. The word for knit in Hebrew is the same as crochet, so although these are crocheted, they have come to be from the Hebrew have come to be called knit. And these are worn by people who don't really want to say how Orthodox they are. They're observant, you know, for sure, but they might also want to look more professional, so they don't want to have something that stands out so much. And the smaller the skull cap, the more moderate you are in your or more worldly you are in your observance. And these knit skull caps with these kind of bands around them are actually the ones that originated the whole knit movement in the first place in Israel. These were worn by settlers in the West Bank who were rather, you know, radically religious Zionist, and so they came to be known as the knit hat people. And so this particular design is favored by them. And finally, we have the socially conscious kippah or skull cap, which are often bought for the guests at bar mitzvahs and weddings. And on the left, you see this one is made out of paper, actually, that's embedded with seeds. The idea being that, you know, so many people go to events and family occasions, and they come back, they have closets filled with yarmulkes and kippot. What you do with them, this one you can actually plant, and it will produce wildflowers. And another socially conscious kippah are the ones that are made in Guatemala, knit kippot, very colorful, often, I think, blending the Guatemalan motifs with Jewish. This one does have a Jewish star on the top, but not quite a Jewish star. And these are done, everything about them is fair trade, the idea being that the women are paid a decent salary, and the cotton is grown in a, you know, environmentally friendly way, et cetera. Everything about it is fair trade. So these are some of the things that when you wear something like this, you communicate, you know, how you feel about your religion or your environment or your society by wearing the skull cap. So it's a form of communication. Those are the objects that we have in the terms of the Judaica, and I think you see that it shows a variety of ways of repetition, a lot of information about religious practice, belief, history, social justice, social issues are embedded in the differences in these objects. And we put the Judaica, and I just want to quickly go through some of the contemporary pieces. Sorry, I have no idea what time it is. I will hurry. I'm almost at the end. In the context of some contemporary works, and I just wanted to show them because they related, we felt that they related to the objects. I just wanted to show them to you. The first is a piece by an Argentinian artist named Amalia Pica, and it's called Stabile or Confetti. It's made out of confetti. that's thrown on the floor. Each time it's installed, it's different, and you tape it to the floor. And kind of the idea behind this is, you know, first there's a repetition in the action, but wherever you buy the confetti locally, so the confetti is always different, and the way that it appears is always different. But also it evokes this kind of event and celebration that must have happened, and you're kind of walking through this, and it's like the party's over, everybody's gone, and you can imagine these conversations that people were having, strangers who meet and maybe tell very, you know, intimate details of their lives or whatever, and then they part and they never meet again. So this idea of communication is very much a part of this artist's work, and the difficulties of communication and the vagaries of communication, and this kind of related to me to the skull caps, which are also methods of communication. This is a work by Sarah Crowner. They're very large canvases, and they look like they're painted onto canvas, but they're actually, each of the colored sections is a separate piece that has been sewn together to make a canvas. So she's combining the art, you know, the textile arts with the art of painting. They are painted or dyed. And these actually, you know, to us were very similar to the Torah binders in the terms of the brightness, the flatness of the colors that are used, the fact that they're actually stitched together because the Torah binders are made of stitched sections. The artist also had a tremendous affinity to them when we showed them to her. She just really related to them. And I think she kind of incorporated some of the spirit of them into what she was doing. She feels that these are like people, and I see what she means. She'd never done that curved form before, and I think it gives it the whole thing a sense of motion and dancing, which is very lovely. This is an African-American artist named Hank Willis Thomas, and a lot of his work is taking from commercial methods of conveying information and then using it to say things about our society, about racism and prejudice. And this one is called Caesar's Visa. It takes two different expressions. There's only three in the show, and what we're trying to show you is that although it has these two expressions, one is it's everywhere you want to be, the life you want to live. These are slogans that came from Caesar's Palace, an advertisement for Caesar's Palace, and for Visa. And he put them together, and then they light up in different ways to form very different phrases. And so the idea is that the words, the letters, are the same, but each sequence is different. And we have three in the exhibition that go off at different times and create different sequences of words. And to me, this related to the Torah binders as well, that you have the same letters, it's the same phrases all the time, but you do different things with them and different things come out and are expressed. Chris Martin is a Belgian artist who, and this is the kind of copy in which he took styrofoam heads that you use to display hats and sunglasses, very cheaply made things that are indestructible and are destroying our planet and are horrible, and he took them and he kind of destroyed them in different ways and then cast them in the most exquisite way, with the most faithful way of reproducing them in bronze. So he took this very ephemeral material, not ephemeral because it doesn't die, but unimportant material, and created something very beautiful out of it. But the destruction of these female faces is, you know, something that's a comment on society. If you think of things that go on where women are disfigured or maimed in some way, or I even think of the Middle East where they're destroying all these ancient statues. The human condition is very strongly reflected in these, and these related to me to those pillar figurines, which are also, and I didn't show you any destroyed ones, but a lot of them are destroyed in different ways. Is that it? And this is a piece made up of 2,400 magnets by Koo Jung-ah, a Korean artist, South Korean artist. What she's playing with here is, first of all, she's using commercial material. It's just a magnet that you could use for any purpose. And she's converting it into a work of art. What you'll notice is that there, although the magnets should be identical, there's a pattern created in them, which is completely random. The art handlers put this together, not the artist. She gave us instructions, but we took the magnets and actually put them together, all 2,400 of them. And also what she's referring to here is that there's something invisible going on here. There's a magnetic force that is keeping these things together and also affects us. When they originally displayed this in London, they had the magnets at full strength and people's pacemakers were getting affected by them. So ours are at 20% strength, so that just shouldn't harm anybody, but there is this idea that a magnetic force can affect you, you know, MRIs, all these kinds of things. And that's what the artist is trying to say, that there are these invisible forces that guide us and can affect us and influence us in different ways. And this, to me, related to the spice containers and the idea that there's an invisible smell that comes out of them that can comfort you, that has an effect on you. And so I had this kind of connection. And then the last work in the show, and I'm not showing you all the contemporary works, but just one that I think is incredibly beautiful, is by an artist named Abram Cruz Villegas. He is Mexican, and what he does is, this is like an autobiography. He takes a moment when he's in traveling in a certain city, and he collects a lot of ephemera, tickets, menus, street maps, whatever, and he paints the back of them, and he creates this assemblage here, usually in the cloud form, and you can't see the underside, the biographical part of it, but what he's referencing are the houses in the areas where he grew up, which were very poor parts of Mexico City, and they used to build their walls by putting in any kind of object they could find. It didn't have to be a piece of building material, it could be a mattress, it could be a watering can, I don't know. And they would embed them in the wall, and then they would plaster them over and paint them over so you couldn't see what was in the wall. And then they would keep taking them out and changing them as they got something better. If you could see the inside of the wall, you'd kind of know what it was made up of, just as if you could see the other side of his work. And this, to me, kind of referred to the marriage contracts in which you are building a home in Jerusalem. But marriage contracts are really designed not just to record the marriage, but in the old days, they were really a safeguard for the woman in case there was a change in the marriage, a divorce or a death. And it was there to protect her and get her money to support herself in those instances. So it's really a document about change, and that's what this is about as well. So I've just given you a very long answer to why the Jewish Museum should keep all of its multiples rather than deaccession them. And what I found was that having them together in one place, in one institution, rather than going all around to different institutions and collectors and digging these things up, was a tremendous boon to scholarship. And that scholarship can then tell us a tremendous amount about how the Jews of previous generations understood their world and how they integrated issues of art and politics and religion into their ceremonies and into their ceremonial art, and how that tradition continues till today. Thank you very much for listening. Any questions? No? Yes? Yes?
My first question is, all these objects, first question is, are all these objects from the Jewish Museum collection?
137 of them are loans. Those were the pillar figurines, because we only had two, and the shekels. The shekels, we had two in the collection. The rest come from the American Numismatic Society. But I wanted to display both of those and talk about them, so I did borrow them. But the rest all come from, the Judaica objects are from the collection. The contemporary works are all borrowed.
Second question is, do you ever have occasion to collect, for example, a print that is exactly the same as another print from the same edition, where you have two of the same? Is there any particular reason you ever consider having two of the same rather than showing the variety of pieces that you collect for different media?
I forgot to mention that I said I wouldn't deaccession what we already had in multiples, but at this point I wouldn't take in any more. So I wouldn't actively collect multiples and duplicates now. It's just, it's a question of the amount of time to care, you know, and care for things and track them and store them. Our storerooms are bulging as it is. And so I wouldn't continue the practice, but I wouldn't get rid of it. Do we have multiple prints? It's not quite my area, but I know that we do. For example, I'm not sure I would keep, if the idea is that if everything is exactly the same and there is no new information, whether it's like a variation in color or it was the same image but produced by two different publishing companies, I would keep any difference that was manifested. But I did deaccession some of those cast things when they were the same generation, exactly the same, nothing different, no new information. That's the instance when I would not collect it or I would deaccession it.
Instead of deaccessioning, would you consider lending them to other institutions?
We're always lending things as other museums wish to borrow them. We do give certain things away that are, you know, that not necessarily, you know, auction them off, but auction is generally considered the best way because it's just sort of the most neutral way. The value is established at the auction. It's not us trying to establish a value. But we do give things away to other institutions. We are open to loan requests anytime, and many institutions do borrow from us.
I also have two questions. One is about copyright issues. Mm-hmm. When you showed the Andy Warhol Mona Lisa, mm-hmm. I guess Mona Lisa would be out of copyright because it's so old anyway, but what if somebody were to copy Andy Warhol? How does that infringe on what artists do? I know in literature and music, there was just this whole big lawsuit with Jay-Z about how much artists own of their own material, and when there is repetition, does that trigger any legal issues? And the second question is more of a comment about the mezuzot. Mm-hmm. You kind of glossed over the fact that they're a marker, and you talked about their spiritual value. I don't know, I'm one of these people, I'm not at all spiritual, I'm pretty religious, but I'm not a spiritual person. And for me, my religion is about identity. Mm-hmm. And so I was poking around, like when I go, I went to buy a summer home and I poked around to see how many mezuzot were on the doors. That would determine whether I would live in that neighborhood. Mm-hmm. You know, just like I went to the supermarket to see how much kosher food was there. When I was 10, my neighbor who had moved in the year before, they had a child and they didn't put a mezuzah on their door. And I, much of my mother's consternation, opened my big mouth and I said, this is really embarrassing. How could you not have a mezuzah? So for me, these mezuzot, these repetitions are such a strong mm-hmm. marker of who we are.
Absolutely.
And buying this as a community. And I think that their spiritual significance, even though the Shema is in them, is relegated to a secondary issue, because I think a lot of people look at mezuzot as these, That's who you are. That's where that blood was, you know, when the Egyptians weren't going to kill you, or God wasn't going to kill you, and they were going to, and he was going to kill the Egyptians. And it's a kind of a line in the sand.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess I'll start with the second, and then go to the first. I mean, I think you've hit on the, you know, one of the things that I couldn't go into all the multiple meanings that any of these objects have for the people who use them and who use them today. So I was just giving the original reason why we put the mezuzot on our door or have, but certainly many people feel it, and I tried to say that it is a marker of a Jewish home because it's at the entrance and it's a very public face, but you're absolutely right. And many people feel it's a very strong part of their identity. I actually have something embarrassing to say. I had a mezuzah on my door and at some point they replaced the whole door frame and door. And I absolutely just didn't think occurred to me that they took the mezuzah until sometime later I realized they no longer had a mezuzah. But it's just, you know, it was important to me to have it, but I guess it was so much a part of my identity. I wasn't looking at it anymore and I didn't realize that it was gone. To get back to the first one about copyright, it's very complicated right now. I'm not an expert in it. We have someone on staff who is much better versed. There are interesting things going on where, for example, the artist Barbara Bloom that I worked with on a show a few years ago wanted to forgot what she, oh, she wanted to use some snippets from audio, from television shows and movies, and we were very concerned about copyright, and so we explored it. There's a big shift going on between fair things being fair use. Museums also used to charge for people to use images of their works, and there's movements away from that now to make everything much more available. There's many artists, Prince is one of them. He's been sued you know, by people, by somebody, I think, Richard Prince, for, because he appropriates, you know, like the Marlboro Man commercial and other artists' work. I think there's a movement to accept all that now, as long as it's by an artist. But the artist's works themselves can be copyrighted. It's very confusing right now. I'm not an expert on it, but it's a good question about replication and what's allowed. You know, there's certain things that go out of copyright, so then we can reproduce them. We have things in our own collection which we can't put on the web because the artist hasn't given us permission, and we respect that. So it's a mixed bag right now. That's what's going on. Anything else? Well, thanks. You've been a great audience. Thank you very much.